Welcome on the AM News. Now, Minister for Roads and Highways, Kwesi Amwakwata, has backtracked from his widely condemned announcement of converting toll booths into urinals. This was after ranking member on Parliament's Roads and Transport Committee, Kwame Agbuja, during the presentation of the reports of the committee on a commercial contract agreement between the Government of Ghana and the BNIP Janson Adosso Consortium of Netherlands for an amount of 200 million euros for the construction of a bridge over the Afram River. That is at the Adosso Echi Amamfrum, disclosed about 4 million cedis of the amount had been earmarked for the construction of toll booths. The Adaklu MP questioned why the minister would, on one hand, seek to convert existing toll booths into urinals and ask for approval to borrow money to construct new ones. The minister interjected, calling the Adaklu MP ignorant. He explained his comments had been taken out of context. Here are excerpts of their altercation on the floor of the House.
Minister is about to borrow an amount of 558,000 Ghana cedi euros, close to 4 million Ghana cedi, to build a new toll booth. You are converting your existing toll booth to toilet, yet you are borrowing 4 million Ghana cedi to build a new toll booth. In this document, is here. Minister, if you haven't read it, this is where it is.
Please read the page.
Read your own document. And Mr. Speaker, we shouldn't allow ministers to think that when they come here, we give them approval, they can go and do whatever they like. He is very ignorant about what he's talking about, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, he is quoting from graphic of Daily Reportage. It was an interview. It's just a small portion that has been turned out. You haven't had the opportunity to listen to the whole interview. Mr. Speaker, I was speaking to the press and they wanted to know the future of all the toll booths. And among others, I said the ministry has plans and government has plans. We are thinking of a lot of ways to put the toll booths. And among them, I said that even the current toll booths, we have about 38 of them, you know, at various vantage points in the country. And as part of it, we are even going to improve the sanitary situation at all these places. For instance, and I said among other things that, for instance, on the highway, and we all see it all the time, vehicles stop indiscriminately, and drivers, passengers get down, and we see people urinating everywhere in the street. It's so indecent. So if among other things, we use this period to improve the sanitary situation at this toll booth, no, we won't even allow drivers to stop in case passengers want to use that facility, among other things. No, it wasn't a statement that I made, it wasn't a report, it was an interview, but that portion was paid, and you do not have access, and you are not privy to the entire interview. And as a member
honorable,
of parliament, why do you think this,
member,
this alone?
Let me put
ignorance.
Honorable Minister, please.
It shall be out of order to use offensive, abusive, insulting, blasphemous, or unbecoming words, or to impugn improper motives to any other member, or to make personal allusions.
Mr. Speaker, with the greatest respect, to he may disagree with the colleague in whatever form, but to describe what he's saying as ignorant and speaking out of ignorance, it is improper in our standard orders.
If I use the word ignorance, that word is not an insult. And somebody is ignorant, and all of us can be ignorant of the facts of an issue. So I was trying to draw my colleague's attention that he is ignorant of the facts of the issue. He was not privy to it, of what I said. So it's not
directly at my colleague. It's not insulting, it's not abuse. I was referring to the fact that he was talking about a subject that he didn't have all the full facts. He was ignorant of what happened and what took place. And Mr. Speaker, that was what I was referring to. And it wasn't an insult, Mr. Speaker.
Honorable Minister.
Well, from there, Minister for Local Government Dan Boche has tasked metropolitan, municipal, and district chief executives across the country to engage their people to understand their needs and concerns in order to ensure government's development agenda is achieved. He's asking all MMDCEs to submit comprehensive reports of site visits undertaken at the end of each year. Mr. Boche has been meeting MMDCEs from the regions up north at a refresher workshop in Tamale.
Pressure course is to provide the MMDCEs with an avenue to share experience with resource persons and experts and also policymakers. It is also to enable them to re-strategize and find practical approaches to solving local governmental challenges. Speaking at the event, Mr. Boche said he would expect a comprehensive report of these engagements at the end of the year.
We acknowledge you, remember, for those of our administration, to interact with the citizens to better understand their needs and develop goals and fashion appropriate plans and programs to address them. He hinted that the best ingredient for success was human relations and charged the Minister of Local Government, which I did, to ensure all MMDCs submit annual itineraries for interactions with residents at the beginning of the year, and to request you to submit comprehensive reports of services undertaken at the end of each year. You will recall that I have directed that you should all submit to my office programs and dates of tentative meetings. And this was submitted to my office 28th January 2022.
The local government minister said to help the MMDCEs succeed in the performance of their functions as well as deepen local government, is determined to prioritize their training and development and tasked the Institute of Local Government to position itself to handle these trainings.
On the delivery of government programs and projects for evidence-based decision-making and policy direction at the central government level. It is a visit that all MMDCs will provide at least quarterly feedback using the dashboard and receive information in areas such as deliberation and administrative functions of the state assemblies, local economic development, revenue organization and management, infrastructure, social services, special initiatives, a program of any national interest. And the institute will give you details of that.
The Northern Regional Minister, Alhaji Shani Alhassan Shaibu, urged the MMDCs to peer review themselves and learn from each other.
Many of you have done your best in such circumstances. But definitely, there is still more we can learn from each other and from others dealing with these issues better. One of the such challenges for many of our assemblies is the issue of low internal generator revenue in Northern Ghana.
On to our next story, and the Peasant Farmers Association of Ghana last year warned of possible famines in Ghana in 2022. The warning followed the shortage of fertilizer, which made it difficult for farmers to produce enough food to meet the country's demands. At the New Year Open Door under the theme 20 Years of Developing Agriculture from the Ground Up, stakeholders indicated the problem persists and called on government to address it before it escalates. Samuel Mbura has more on the story.
Speaking to Joy News in an interview at the New Year Open Door Day lunch under the theme 20 years of developing agriculture from the ground up by the International Fertilizer Development Center, which was established in 2002 in Ghana to produce and promote local economic development by increasing food and agricultural productivity through effective and environmentally sound crop nutrient technologies and agribusiness expertise using the bottom-up approach, Regional Director for North and West Africa of IFDC, Dr. Umu Kamara, raised concerns about the global rise in demand for fertilizer.
Yes, fertilizer prices currently are at their highest around the world, not just Africa, but our farmers are most vulnerable. So the strategies for making sure farmers get the needed fertilizer on time at an affordable price.
But Fred Jassy, who is with Africa Fertilizer Organization, has reviewed the unavailability of a primary source of fertilizer in the country.
To produce fertilizers, that is the primary production of fertilizers, you need natural resources. To produce nitrogen fertilizer, you need gas to produce urea. And currently, I know that the government of Ghana is working on having a gas urea production plant in Ghana, but it's in the pipeline stages, so they don't have it set up yet.
Meanwhile, fertilizer research and responsible implementation has indicated that fertilizer usage in the country is on the rise and cautioned farmers to apply it responsibly.
At the moment, I would say fertilizer application in Ghana has increased. Some few years ago, we were around 16 kilograms per hectare per farmer, but at the moment, we are getting closer to 30 kilograms per farmer. Due to the introduction of the Planting for Food and Jobs program, you know, fertilizer usage has gone up. And at the moment, Ghana is around 25 to 30 kilograms per hectare per capita.
For the agri sector to develop in the country, government will have to base its strategy on the development of public-private partnership as drivers of change by developing innovative approaches to improving the governance of agricultural value chain. For Joy News, Samuel Mbura, Accra.
Let's talk social advocacy now. And the chief of Breman Jamra is hailing the multimedia group for blazing the trail in impactful journalism. This comes as the group mobilizes public support to help build a safer school block for the community. Jasehene Nanakwesi Enin, the third, while urging multimedia to keep up the good work, also appealed for more public support to complete the work on schedule. There's more in this report.
The multimedia group's classroom project is tailored towards promoting philanthropy for development at the community level without looking up to the central government or donor support. The construction of a three-unit classroom block at Breman Jamra is one of the many development projects the community needs. The initiative has since won the hearts of the traditional leaders.
And let me take this opportunity to thank multimedia. It's not about the yesterday journalism that we all know. This one is journalism about the challenges people are facing in their communities. And it's a plus for multimedia. My prayer is that when this project is done, you will not just move to, is it Toron? You told us that you are doing one in Toron. You do that one and go to other communities as well.
Unlike before, work on site has slowed down a bit in the last couple of days due to dwindling community participation. The traditional authorities are not too happy and have been calling for additional support.
Today's communal labor is not like yesterday. Hitherto, the community was a very small area, a mechanical solidarity community. So immediately, there's a gongong bita. Everybody comes on board to do the work. They will come to the work from 6 a.m., 11 a.m. Then they go. The demolition returns set in. And so from 11 upwards, what happens? We engage some technical people. Then the community pays them. So this is our challenge. We need, we will continue to ask humbly. So as to get the needed support to complete the project on time.
There has been a long time perception of people, particularly Ghanaians, that government should provide everything. So in the meantime, what we've been doing, we've been engaging them, we've been talking to them, to sort of work on their psyche that times have changed and the government cannot do everything. So that is the solution that we are using to solve this challenge. But so whilst we are speaking to them, we're talking to them, if like Nana said, if the people who are helping us, if they can donate some more, just something small to motivate them. We are looking at the time that the project should end. Okay, that's where the issue is.
Despite the challenge, some of the community members have been expressing their commitment to seeing the project through completion.
It's all about leadership, so I see it as possible. We'll be able to finish the project within the 10 days. We'll have to meet our people again and talk to them.
Mission Kwanda, I'm a man when Oba, Yahweh, Yantuan, I'm my first word, my about some of the my friends, Niabre, see, I am Ramasumi.
Edmund de a man years from say, yeah. Sanya Mobuayan, a science for Yabua, yeah. As a school, no, who will be see what ma, bones are before you, baby. School down here into my minkum, Namincusiade. Nina, Adam, a beman crash hammer or may.
The classroom project is brought to you kind Ketsi, the Star Ghana Foundation, with funding from the Dutch Foreign Affairs Ministry. It is supported by the Israeli Embassy, Forestry Commission, the Planned City Extension Project, DBS Roofing Sheets, and JU, our cherished audiences. The classroom project, promoting social justice through philanthropy.
You can still lend your support to us, whether in cash or in other means, as we help the people of Bremer and Jambra. That's how we wrap the AM news, but there's a lot more coming your way as we get into the papers for the news review. Do stay. We'll be right back.